sea of change. You can't keep anything you take. The lovely face of lives we chased is but dust for wind to take. When all is gone, the only loss to not have loved at every cost. When you can say, and I can say, we loved with every step we take. Oh, be okay, how do you love when your heart is broken? And how do you speak when you feel outspoken? Well, I can forgive and be forgiven by learning to heal with the heart wide open. With open hearts, despite the stakes, we take a chance on our mistakes. A brand new day we will embrace, an open wound that heals with grace. And all the fears that we will face in this time and in this place, when you can say, and I can say, we loved with every step we take.
Everyone, I'm excited to be here today with you. I've been here before, and it's one of my sacred spaces that I come and visit when I've written books, and I want to share what the information is in them. So I'm really excited to be here, and I'm on book tour for this book called The Empath Survival Guide, Life Strategies for Sensitive People. And the reason I feel so strongly about this book is that I'm a psychiatrist and I'm also an empath. And what is an empath? An empath is somebody who is an emotional sponge, who is very open, intuitive, has a strong inner life, sensitive, giving, but we don't have the same filters that other people have or guards up, so we tend to absorb things into our own bodies in terms of energy, emotions, physical symptoms, what's going on in the news or our world atmosphere, and we take it on in our bodies. And the downside of being an empath is that you tend to get exhausted or sick or depressed or anxious. Anxiety is a big symptom of being an empath if you don't have protection and centering techniques. And so I wanted to write this book to share with you the techniques I use in my life, because I need to use a lot of techniques to stay grounded so I don't take on your stuff. As if I traveled around and I took on your pain or your suffering, and everyone is pain and suffering. So it's just the nature of being human. And it's part of our spiritual path is to learn how to work with whatever challenges that are brought to us and look at them as spiritual challenges. Whatever it is, depression, anxiety, loss, everything is a spiritual challenge to teach us to open our hearts. You see, but empaths are a little bit different. I'm not saying they're better or worse than other people. It's just a different type of person that needs to come out of the closet, because many empaths are afraid of expressing their sensitivities, afraid of saying, you know, I am intuiting you. I am feeling you. I am an energy being that has an energy field that goes through my body and extends way beyond my body, and I can feel that. I not only feel what your words are, I feel what's unspoken. I feel what's in your energy, and I honor that. And I don't talk myself out of it, and I don't second guess it. Because I believe in this day and time, empaths need to come into their power. We need you empaths to come out now. We need you not to hide. We need you to be strong and confident in who you are. And so for those of you who don't know if you're an empath, let me read you some of the questions and the quiz in the front of the book. How many of you think you are empaths before I read? No. This is a room full of empaths. How many of you don't think you are? Only a few. And how many of you who don't think you are want to be in support of a loved one who is? Okay, so that's pretty much everyone in the room. Isn't that interesting? How about over here? What about that man? Are you in support of somebody who's an empath? This man right here with the gray hair and the blue shirt? He's looking around. You. Are you in support of an empath or somebody sensitive that you love? Oh, the loved ones are claiming themselves. Denial is right. That's why I picked you. There's a... Yeah, you're in support. You have a lot of your community are empaths, and they need your understanding and love. Okay, just to keep that in mind. He's a little flabbergasted, but... You know, as an empath and intuitive, I'm drawn to talk to certain people, and you are the one at this particular moment, so take it with a grain of salt. But I really think you could play a role in supporting others in coming into their own sensitivities. You can, oh, there's someone coming over to you right now, right there. Right when I said that. All right, it's more than a coincidence. All right, just food for thought. But I'll read you some of the questions and see if you identify. Have I ever been labeled as overly sensitive, often meant as a put-down?
No.
No. And that was a man who said that. Excellent. Excellent. Do I often feel like I don't fit in? As empaths often feel like they don't fit in this world. But if you feel that you don't fit in, you're here to create a better world. That's why you're here. Do noise, smells, or nonstop talkers overwhelm me? Another man let out a yell. That's great. Do nonstop talkers overwhelm you? No. He can handle anything. He has such a big heart. Do I have chemical sensitivities or a low tolerance for scratchy clothes? Oh, over here, there's a lot over there of chemical sensitivities. It's amazing how they all group together. People with similar, but they're not as much identifying on the right with that. That's interesting. Do I prefer taking my own car places so that I can leave when I please? All right, and why do you think that is? Anybody who just laughed and identified? So overwhelm? Yeah, so you can escape. And that's good. I just want to say that if you're an empath, I support you in setting your limits and boundaries for time socializing. No, that's really important. You don't have to go somewhere and be stuck there for 5 hours. You don't. Even if the event lasts for 5 hours, you can leave at 1 hour, at 2 hours. No, I give myself permission to do that, where I tell my friends, what you have to do is have creative conversations with people about your needs. You know, I tell my friends, you know, I can only stay for a couple hours, so if you drive with me, you know, be prepared to leave. And if they don't, they say, okay, well, take your own car. But the point is, you have, you know, if you want tools and you want to set boundaries, you have to be able to talk this way to the people that you love so they understand you. The problem is many empaths don't speak up and just go places and suffer. And you don't want to do that. You know, you want to be brave and have courage and speak up and speak your needs, whatever they are, empathic needs, your authentic needs, your needs in relationship. Now, you need to speak up and not keep it to yourself and just put up with things, because you need to live an authentic life. We're here, born here on Earth, and the Earth plane has light and dark energies here. And it's a spiritual school, you know, as I believe it, that we're here to learn things. And I mean everything. I mean nothing excluded. Everything that comes to you in your life is a lesson. And I try and lead my life that way. And if you're an empath, you were born with this sensitivity because it's a gift. And you want to be able to give yourself the gift of your powers and your empathy to nurture yourself. And you want to also awaken your community with the power of empathy and not be afraid to feel for people. Because empathy is the ability to have your heart reach out to somebody else and feel what's going on inside of them. The Dalai Lama says empathy is the most precious of human qualities. You know, if you can really take that in, empathy is the most precious of human qualities. And empathy means that your heart goes out to someone even if you don't like them, even if you don't agree with them. You see, and that's a big evolutionary shift because it's your only hope of building bridges. Do you get that? Okay, is that something that you practice in your spiritual practice, empathy, as opposed to holding judgment and differences and polarizing and this one's so bad and this one's so good and, you know, that's not going to get us anywhere. But if you can reach your heart out, that is the secret. Do I overeat to cope with stress? Again, on this side. How about on this side? There's a hand. There's a few hands. Because let me tell you about empaths, because there's a chapter in here on empaths and addiction. You know, I treat many people in recovery who are also recovering empaths. Because empaths get overloaded by the world, and they have excessive stimulation. And so many empaths reach out to drugs, alcohol, sex, food, any addictive behaviors to try and numb their sensitivities. Is there anyone that can relate here to that? Yeah. And so when you go into recovery and you become clean and sober, or you go into a food program, you have to learn to work with your sensitivities, you know, without reaching out for substances. And this is a form of empowerment. But I just wanted to say that the turn of the century faith healers were often these very obese women. And they claimed they needed to have all this armor and fat on them in order not to absorb your pain. You know, they had patients, they didn't want to absorb the pain, but they felt that the mass was the armor, which it can work as an armor, truly, it can work. And they didn't want to give it up because they felt that was the only tried and true method. But what it does is if you're absorbing, as empaths do, and many healers, many people who are healthcare practitioners are empaths, many givers, physical therapists, if you have somebody's pain or toxic energy, or if you meet an energy vampire, somebody who saps your energy, you're around them and you just notice your energy going down, there's a chapter on that too. It's the buffer, the fat slows down the energy from coming in. It's true, but it's not a healthy coping mechanism. But it's just something I want to bring to your attention, you know, in case this is an issue for you, because oftentimes it's a missing piece to overeating, you know, if you deal with the energetic component. And one quick way to deal with it is to put a meditation cushion by your refrigerator. And it's really helpful because it stops you from opening the door, and it allows you to sit. All right, here's this sacred cushion sitting there, and you're heading, you know, you're overwhelmed, you're on sensory overload, you want the food to buffer, to stop the negative energy from coming in. That's the process. You don't think about it that way, but that's what's happening subliminally. So here's the cushion, and so there it is, thank God. And you sit there, and you close your eyes, you put your hands together, you put your hands on your heart, you start channeling your heart energy, which is the healing energy, and you start bringing the chaotic energy to center, and you breathe, and you center, and you feel calmer, and you feel bliss, and that door no longer looks so appealing. So it's a meditation intervention. You know, you can do that for yourself. You keep it there. But if it's not there, you don't have the visual cue. You see, so you need that visual cue in order to stop yourself. And what can make you feel safe? This book is about protection strategies that can make you feel safe. So you don't have to overeat. You don't have to go to a drug. You don't have to go to an addictive relationship. You don't have to become a workaholic and work to numb your sensitivities. You learn to come back in meditation to your heart. Now, that's one technique I talk about, the 3-minute meditation. To learn how to bring yourself back. As a psychiatrist, I do this between patients, where I stop. Do you do it too? You two down here who are nodding? Yeah. I stop in between the patients. I sit, I center myself, I come to my heart, I breathe, I slow down my breath, I slow down my heart rate so I can come back down to the stillness and the inner point inside that I'm so comfortable with. Now you want to find that sense of comfort in your body to come back to and breathe out anything you've taken on, because their emotional impasse take on emotions. Physical empaths can take on physical symptoms. And so you want to just breathe out anything you've taken on, or if I've taken on anything in a session, I breathe it out, center myself, and then I'm fresh and new for the next person coming in. Isn't that interesting? But you have to learn how to do that as part of your spiritual practice, now as part of your cleansing practice. You know, to be able to not panic if you notice that you've taken on energy, and to ask yourself that question, because most empaths don't. They don't ask themselves the question, is this emotion mine or another person's? You know, if I'm in an interaction, you know, and I start feeling different, if I start feeling drained, is this me or is this the person? Because empaths can take on. You know, they're emotional sponges. They can take on what's going on in other people. And so when you ask yourself that question, and a quick way to find out is to distance yourself 20 feet or so, and then you can see if it's you or the person when you get outside the realm of their energy field. And you can test it out. And so learning to be a conscious empath is really important. But there's a chapter in here on energy vampires, and we'll go into this in the workshop today. I can't go into all the strategies, but the workshop is going to be very strategy-oriented. But if you deal with narcissists or other energy vampires in your life, and you're a sensitive person, that could take a big toll. And so you need to develop strategies. I see some people smiling over here, you know, to deal with that. And the narcissist is the most dangerous energy vampire for empaths. There's a toxic attraction between narcissists and empaths that you need to know about. I'll go into greater detail. But those of you who have found yourself in relationships with narcissists, you really need to deal with it. And if you've had parents who are narcissists and you keep attracting narcissistic partners, this is a pattern you need to watch out for, because you don't want to keep repeating it. And subliminally, what empaths do to try and heal that narcissistic wound is they attract narcissistic partners to try and heal the narcissistic parent relationship. And you hope that you'll change the narcissist, and that will never happen, by the way. Just so you all are absolutely clear on that. It will never happen. But the desire is there, and I mention it to you because it's unconscious. You don't know you're doing it most of the time. And whereas empaths, there's an empathic spectrum. There's low and there's high. There's very high empathy, and that's the empath, somebody who is supercharged with their empathy and needs to find centering techniques. Then on the other side of the spectrum, the zero side, is the narcissist, sociopath, and psychopath. And these people have what are called empathy deficient disorders. All right, I want you to get this. They don't have empathy in the way that we know empathy, all right? They don't have the capacity to care about your feelings. All right, and this is so protective for sensitive people to know. And the reason empaths are attracted to narcissists is because they're so charming and they're so seemingly loving in the beginning, and they know what to say to reel you in, and they pull on your heartstrings, and they're intuitively geniuses, you know, in terms of knowing what to say. And so, you know, your empathic heart goes, this is a beautiful person. You know, and I like this person, especially if you haven't been in a relationship for a long time. And here comes this charmer who's saying all the right things, you know. But the way to know if you're involved with a narcissist, go to this book, look at the signs and symptoms. Very charming in the beginning, but the minute you don't go along with their program, they get cold, withholding, and punishing, and give you the silent treatment. And they aren't capable of giving you the empathy you deserve. These are not potential partners, all right? For any of you who are thinking about that or get taken in by a narcissist, they will not make a good partner, all right? Because they can't give you the love you need. And this is where sensitive people get taken in, because they don't get that somebody isn't capable of this. So these kind of awarenesses we'll talk about in the workshop. But you know, for some reason I feel drawn to talk about this in the group, in case you've ever had an encounter with a narcissist in your romantic life, in your work life, if your parents were narcissists. And sometimes you could have a narcissistic child, and that's very difficult to have a narcissistic child. But is there anyone here who... You do. Okay, interesting. But the advantage of this is your child has you, and you can be the guide, and you can help the child be of more service to other people. You know, teach the child to give, because the only real recovery that I've seen with narcissists, they don't do well in therapy, by the way, because they always think you're the problem. They won't own it. They can't own it. And if they do own it, it's only lip service. So you don't get very far. But if they go into 12-step programs, you know, then if they're lucky enough to be, you know, in a 12-step program, then part of that program is service work and giving back. And so they're forced to, you know, go on prison panels and give to other people, which is so helpful. You see, and empaths need to find relationships, friends, work situations, peripheral people who are going to honor your needs, and a narcissist won't. Okay, so just to be clear, you know, and I keep repeating this because people don't get it. Now, empaths don't grasp, you know, empaths are so sensitive, they don't grasp that somebody maybe can't reciprocate in the same way, that maybe someone doesn't have as big a heart as you, you know, that you can't reform them. And if you had a narcissistic parent, you're not going to reform the narcissistic mate. Just know that. All right, I felt moved to tell this audience that, and I see a lot of heads nodding. But in terms of relationships, empaths need to express their authentic needs in friendships, in relationships in this community, and I know they often hold back. And so in a relationship, I want to say that empaths have special needs. That's been one of my biggest challenges. How do I be an empath, you know, with a partner? Because I'm very comfortable alone. I'm very comfortable single. I'm very comfortable with my own quiet time. Empaths need alone time, tremendous amount of alone time. So how do you actually love someone in an intimacy level and express your needs? And that's been a great lesson for me in saying I need alone time, in saying I have a sign on my door saying I'm meditating, do not disturb. So nobody intrudes and nobody hovers, you know, because empaths can feel the hovering. If somebody's waiting for you, you know, that's not going to work either. You know, and to be able to say, you know, I need my separate sleep time tonight, if indeed I do. And that you're not forced to sleep in the same bed with somebody, because sometimes empaths just can't do that because they're light sleepers and they get woken up. And so all of these are special needs for empaths that are fine. You just have to express yourself. And your spiritual practice as an empath and your intuitive practice is very important, that you nurture this, that you continue it for a lifetime. And you need to have a partner who's not going to be blaring the TV when you're meditating. All right? If you have a small space, you have to get the partner earbuds. So all of these things need to be spoken about. You know, the radio can't be blasting, and he or she can't be on the phone if you can hear them, because empaths are noise sensitive. You know, they're very, very noise sensitive. They're smell sensitive. They're very strong sense of smell, strong noses, so you can smell a lot. Where I could go into an elevator and there could be perfume left over lingering, and to me it's suffocating. But to a friend, it's like, oh, isn't that a beautiful smell? All right, so it's just a difference in perceptions. But what empaths do is they don't honor their own needs, and they think there's something wrong with them. They say, I'm neurotic, I'm too sensitive, I need to get a thicker skin, as my mother, who was a doctor, told me. Now she said, oh dear, you just have to get a thicker skin. You know, that's not helpful. You know, that's not helpful to tell to a child or an adult. What is helpful is to say, wow, tell me more about what you're feeling. Wow, I can really honor that in you. You know, to have somebody who says, I honor that. I love you for that. I embrace you for who you are. But you have to tell them who you are. You know, if you keep it quiet, because a lot of empaths keep it quiet, then, you know, they'll never know. All right, and you have to say, you know, this is who I am. And if you're dating someone or if it's a new friend, you have to let them know, I'm a sensitive person. And sometimes I need to be alone. And if they say, oh, great, you know, thank you for telling me, then that's a potential friend. But if they say, oh, really? You know, or have some derogatory comment, not good. All right, so you can kind of test people out. You know, and if you suspect someone is a narcissist, the way you know that is to provoke a conflict early on. I guess you've all known narcissists, haven't you? There's an epidemic of them everywhere now. I mean, that's part of our collective lesson, is to not give them power. You know, you want to have empaths in power. You want to have loving, heart-centered people, you know, who are our leaders. Our leaders need to be healers, you know, not politicians to me. They need to be healers and be skilled in the healing arts and know how to be empathic and know human nature and care about human nature. Because intuitively, if you tune in and use your sixth sense, you can feel how connected everyone is. Everyone in this room has an invisible connection of light. And we're all so similar. As human beings, we all have the same package. We all were born here with the emotions to deal with, the physical issues to deal with, the body to deal with. The spirit's so huge that suddenly we have to adjust to being in the body. I feel we need an education about that early on so we can adjust better. It's very odd for people who have memories of being spirit, you know, your spirit realm suddenly being confined to a body. So it's good to talk about that with your empathic children. You know, how many of you have empathic children, empathic grandchildren? Yeah, I would have these conversations, you know, and support your children. The boys often have the hardest times. The sensitive boys who have, you know, these beautiful hearts and sensitivities, they don't want to play with the video games that are loud and violent. You know, they don't want to go on the football team and get beaten up with sports. No, they don't want to do any of those things. They want to go in the forest. They want to read poetry. They want to have introspection. So you want to encourage boys to come out in their sensitive power and to not become overly feminized, to have a strong masculine, but also encourage them to shine their sensitivities forth. We need men who are sensitive and not afraid to show it. That's a sign of strength. It's an attraction. It's not a weakness. And our society doesn't really support sensitive boys. So for those parents, for those friends of sensitive boys, for those sensitive boys who have grown up into adults now who are never supported, I hope you can support them. Say, tell me, I love you. I love your feelings. I love your sensitivity. You don't have to hide it from me. You can be yourself and you can shine, and I love you and I support your sensitivities. That's so great to say to all men and all women. And that's what I want this book to do, to be a support for you, to be the place where you can see that you're okay. And there's nothing wrong with you. There's never been anything wrong with you. And if you've been diagnosed as agoraphobia, anxiety disorder, depression, and you've been given medications, that's not the primary treatment for being an empath. Unfortunately, it isn't, but that's important to know, because so many empaths come to me as a psychiatrist overly medicated and pathologized, and by the time they get to me, they think there's something terribly wrong with them. And so I have to start from square one. All right, take the self-assessment quiz of, are you an empath? I have to make that diagnosis. And I encourage all healthcare practitioners to diagnose their empath patients from the beginning. Ask these questions. Do you need a lot of alone time? Do you get overwhelmed in crowds? Do you prefer one-to-one interactions in small groups rather than large groups? There's certain qualifiers that empaths have. Do you have strong intuition? Are you an animal empath? Animal empaths are a kind of intuitive empath that can sense and commune with the animal world. It's a very special gift. And they're not making it up, and animals aren't on some lower spiritual plane than us. I don't think so. I think that we have the capacity to connect on an empathic level that's very deep and very precious. And I want to support that in you. And everyone who's listening who wants to have these sensitivities supported, I hope you're getting a big yes inside. And I hope you're acknowledging this in yourself. I mean, even, sometimes when I talk to audiences, the empathic child in you gets awakened. And all of the times you were sensitive and open as a child and never got supported for it. So you need to bring about that inner child and nurture him or her now and say, I'm going to take care of you, honey, right now. And I'm going to pretend. Ooh, a child. That child heard me. Did you hear that? Isn't that wonderful? It's a great synchronicity that happens. A child called out. When I said support your child's sensitivities, we had a great cry. So notice synchronicities in your life. Pay attention to what happens when you're feeling something, when somebody's talking. The world will conspire to support you if the message is right. Now, you must believe that, and don't just become single-focused. Be aware of the synchronicities in your life. Have multi-intuitive focus. Empaths can do that. And sensitive people can do that. Maybe you don't identify as an empath, but you're a sensitive, loving person who wants to keep their heart open in a very coarse, stressful world. How do you do that? How do you do that without subtly sealing off? That's important, to learn how to keep your heart open. And you seal off when you feel threatened, when you feel overwhelmed, when you go on overload of some sort. That's when you start subtly sealing off, and you don't want to do that. Instead, you want to say, okay, I'm shutting down. What can I do to bring myself together? And there's a wonderful, if you connect to animals, there's a wonderful meditation I sometimes use if I want protection, where I picture a jaguar patrolling my space. I love the jaguar. The jaguar will protect you. The woman with the blonde hair in the middle, I think you would like that. Yeah, she knows who I'm talking about. Where some people resonate with animals, and you can take power animals and have them allies, have them protect you. And even if this sounds far out to you, I don't know if it does or it doesn't, it works. But you have to resonate with it. And, in the workshop, I hope you can come to it, we'll talk about many, many, many techniques. And I hope if you identify as an empath, or you love an empath, or you want to support your child, or you want to support somebody who's sensitive in your life, you can use the tools in here to do that. Because what that does is that ignites light. in them. When you can support truly who somebody is who's been hiding, you want to encourage them. So many empaths are telling me, you know, oh, now I know who I am. You know, now I know what I am, so, and I can embrace it. You know, it's so important. If you identify in this area, and you don't have to, you know, there are different types of people, but if you do, and I know there's lots of us out there, I wanted to bring it to your consciousness to be aware of, to love and nurture this part of yourself. And so, you know, it's just been such a great honor sitting and talking to you. Your energy is so beautiful and your presence is so complete, all of you, as I've been talking, that I really appreciate that. And I am just so grateful for your invitation to speak to this beautiful community. So hopefully I'll see some of you later in the workshop. Thank you.